I ain't hear you.
You need
to rest and see that. I didn't always. Uh-oh. I didn't always. It seems like I do now. All right, they're going to be coming on in. Hallelujah.
But they tell me of a
home. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you. It's that time to go into the word of the Lord. I tell you, God bless you, mother. God bless you, mother. Hey, bro, good to see you. C. Banks, what's happening? One of the best musicians out there, I'm telling you. One of the greatest. Bless you, bless you. Sister Angie, good to see you, good to see you. Good evening, mother. Hey, mama. God bless you, God bless you. Yes, yeah, we give them a few more minutes to come on in. I appreciate you all, I tell you. I've been anticipating coming down here and just relating to the people of God. Thank you all so much. Hey, evangelist, God bless you, God bless you. God bless you. Do I need to bring this a little closer, Jazzy? I'm all right. I'm okay. All right. God bless you. To God be all the glory. Yes, yes, yes. Most definitely. Thank you all so much. Bless you, Deacon College. God bless you. I see you, Stacy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless you, Elder Campbell. God bless you. Amen, amen. I see the saints are coming on in. Bless you, Sister Cookie. You've been in our prayers. Amen, amen. Everybody, all of y'all been in my prayers. Amen. Hey, Stacy, tell everybody I said hello. Please, please. Uncle Mike, I love you, man. This is my uncle. Bless you, Bishop Jones. Bless you, bless you, bless you. Amen, amen. God bless you, Deke. Deke, you blessed my heart this morning, this afternoon. Amen, when we spoke. God bless you. God bless you. Hey, I love y'all. I love y'all. I know we love each other. Hey, Cedric. All right. I was thinking about your niece this morning. Please tell Sugar Mama I love her. Amen. Love on her for me. Please, 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 please. God bless you. God bless you. Hey, Nikki, I miss y'all singing up there on the praise team. We'll be back after a while. We'll be back after a while. We'll be back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Maintain your praise. Maintain your praise. That's right. Yes, yes, yes. Amen. Make sure you tell her. Make sure you love on her real good. Make sure you love on her real good. Real good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Make sure y'all share if you would. Amen. Please share. Please share. Let them know that we're on right now. Let them know that Bishop is on. And I'm on my personal page, as you already know. You know, so please share. Please share. Bless you. Bless you, Pastor McIntosh. It's good to see you, man. I love you, man. Love you. Bless you, Elder. Amen, amen, amen. Bless you. Bless you. We were praying for you and your family yesterday. It was yesterday we called you all's name in prayer. Bless you, Bishop. God bless you. God bless you. Constantly in prayer. Constantly in prayer. We talked about intercession last week. We're going to, amen, get started in just a few more minutes. Amen. Amen. I love y'all so much. I can feel the prayers of the people. I can feel the prayers of the people. I can feel the prayers of the people. And I mean that. I mean that. There is a word from the Lord. There is a word from the Lord. There is a word from the Lord. And I love each and every one of you all. Trust everybody is doing well. That's been my prayer, that God will continue to cover and keep and trust that everybody is doing well, doing well, doing well. Blessings to you and your family. Amen, amen. We're going to be all right. Amen. Stay in that word and watch what God does for us. Amen. Dr. Burton, God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Apostle McKinnis, I was just talking about you today. Amen. Was just talking about you today. Told people I've been preaching for Apostle since I was in my 20s. Amen. Thank you for every open door and all the opportunities. Amen. Sister Jackie, we're always holding you up in prayer. We know you work in that medical field. Amen. You and Mother. Amen. Mother Sauls, we know that you are working in that medical field, and our prayers are definitely with you that God will continue to cover and keep you in the name of Jesus. Let's pray now. We're going to go into the word of the Lord. Gracious and eternal Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for life. We thank you for health. We thank you for strength. God, we thank you for your supply and provisions, Father. Thank you for sustaining us, oh God, thus far. You've did it in the past, you're doing it now, and you're gonna do it again and again. God, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that you will speak a word, Father, for these next few moments, that you will speak a word, and that word will be the lamp unto our feet and to the light unto our path. God, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that any stress be removed right now. Any burdens be lifted. Father, every yoke be destroyed. In the name of Jesus. God, I thank you right now, Father, for being the author and the finisher of our faith. The great and mighty God you are. And for this, we praise you and we bless you right now. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. If you agree that Jesus is the best thing, I want you to send up some hearts and some likes there, some thumbs up, that Jesus is the best thing that has ever happened to us. He's the best thing that has ever happened to you. He's the best thing. Come on, that's your amen. Bless you, Mother. That's your amen, that Jesus is the best thing that has ever happened to us. Hey, sis down in the 757. Jesus is the best thing. Come on, let's bombard it. Jesus is the best thing that has ever happened to us. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, over and over again. Let this be your praise. Come on, and even while you're in your homes or in your wherever, hopefully you're at home, amen. Let this be your praise. Open your mouth and say, Jesus is the best thing, the best thing, the best thing, the best thing that has ever happened to me. And for this, we say thank you and we bless you. Amen. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hey, sis, good to see you. Love on mom for me, Mother Verna. Love on her. All right, let's go into the word of the Lord. Let's go into the word of the Lord. I tell you all the time, I do best, amen, when I teach and preach. Amen. I'm going to teach, amen, what it is that I pray. And I've been praying. When I tell you that we've been praying over here, we have been praying and just believing God to do great and mighty things for his people. I mean that. Now, let me make a few observations. Bless you, Elder Blaine. Thank you so much for reaching out, amen, to different ones and all of you all who are reaching out. God bless you. Let me say this right here. No man is an island. No man stands alone, alrighty? We all need each other. We all need each other. Please hear me on that. We all need each other. And so make sure you reach out. Give somebody a wellness call. Just check on them. I know you may not talk to them all the time. Shoot them a text or something. Hey, just want to make sure you're doing all right. Call their names in prayer. We talked about it last week about intercessory prayer. Call their names in prayer. Call their names in prayer. Please pray for me. Pray for my family. Amen. We solicit your prayers. All is well. Amen. But we need prayer. We need prayer. We need prayer. And you need prayer too. And please know that I am praying for you. I mean that without a doubt, that I am praying for you. Now, let's go into the word of the Lord. I want to give you an Old Testament scripture and a New Testament scripture, alrighty, and let's make just a few points, alrighty. Isaiah chapter number 26, verse number 3, and 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16. And I'll tell you, I've been praying that God will keep the minds of his people, that God will keep us in perfect peace, and that he will keep our minds. Now, I want this lesson to create a prayer agenda for you. Sometimes you go on to pray. You say, God, what should I pray? I don't know what to pray. Take notes. Arm yourself with a writing utensil. Amen. With a writing pen or something. Amen. And take notes and just begin to pray. All right, pray. Make some notes and begin to pray. All right, Isaiah 26:3 says, thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. I will keep thee, or thou will keep thee in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. That's Isaiah 26:3. And if you can, you know, I try to tell you all at Life Changing and our ministry partners, thank you so much for tuning in, alrighty, to try to charge it to memory. Try to learn the scripture per day if you can, alrighty. Try to learn one per day, and you'll be surprised how the Holy Ghost will begin to bring them back to your remembrance. All right, Isaiah 26:3, thou will keep thee in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. And then 1 Corinthians 2:16, for who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? This is the part I want to lift. But we have the mind of Christ. But we have the mind of Christ. And I've been praying that God will keep the minds of his people, especially in these times, that God will keep the minds of his people. Now, I want you to understand something here. I've done a little research and studies, and they show that the average mind, I don't know what the average mind is, but they said the estimated average mind person makes about 60 to 80,000, have about 60 to 80,000 thoughts a day. That's what they said, that the normal mind person has about 60 to 80 thoughts a day. This is an average of about 2,500 to 3,300 thoughts per hour. I'm telling you, your mind is a sharp instrument. 60 to 80 thoughts a day and about 2,500 to 3,300 thoughts per hour. This is something, because as I began to write this the other day, I began to ask God, I said, wow, if we were able to sell our thoughts, what would they be worth? I mean, think about that. Everything that you see around you was once an idea, once a thought, alrighty? And so it's something. Now, the importance of the mind is important. The reason why the mind is important is because that's where we serve God from, according to Romans 7:25. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So with my mind, I serve the law of God. I'm telling you now, we serve God with our minds. And this is why the aim of the enemy, this is why the enemy wants to attack the minds of the people of God. Because if he gets your mind, nothing else matters. He's not after your house. He's not after your car. He's not after your spouse. He's not after your children. He's after your mind. Because if he gets your mind, I'm telling you, he's got you. But I decree and I declare that the devil is a bold-faced liar, that even in these times, even in these days that we are faced with, that God is going to keep us in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Now, I want you to understand something here. Our purpose of life and our pattern of life, they kind of run together. Once you understand your purpose of life, then you can move into your pattern of life. Alrighty? The purpose of life is one word, Christ. That's our purpose of life, Christ. Philippians 1:21 says, for to me to live is Christ. For to live is Christ. Get that in your mind. Get that in your heart. That, guess what? My purpose of life is Jesus Christ. This is why we live, because he died. And because he died for us, we ought to live for him. That's Galatians 2:20. Talks about him being crucified for us, and we're being crucified with him. And the life that we live, we do not live of our own, but we live according into Jesus Christ here. 1 Corinthians 6:19 talks about that. Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? You don't belong to yourself. You don't belong to yourself. You're a blood-washed believer. You do not belong to yourself. You know, I tell people sometimes, it's like when you join the military. When you join the military, they change everything. They change your hairstyle. Come on, we got some military folk that can attest to this here. They change how you greet one another. They change what you wear. In other words, they begin to mold your mindset. And it's the same way when we come to know Christ. You can't say what you want to say, do what you want to do. I know I'm about to mess somebody up right now. You can't act the way you want to act and wear what you want to wear and call yourself in the army of the Lord. It don't work like that. You don't own yourself. He died for us. We must live for him. Now, I know this kind of teaching, it's not popular and sought after, but it's this type of teaching that'll assure you to get to heaven. Y'all ain't talking back to me here. Alrighty. So he died for us. We live for him. And in order to live for him, you got to understand that the pattern to live for Christ is to have his mind. Now, once we understand that our purpose of life is Christ, then the pattern of our life is the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ. This is what Philippians 2 and 5 says. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Jesus had a mind to serve. He had a mind to serve. You can read that there. He took upon him the form of a servant. And then not only that, but he had a mind to submit. Oh, let me drop a dime in the meter right there. He had a mind to serve and he had a mind to submit. Your fleshly mind doesn't want to submit. Your fleshly thoughts does not want to submit. So that's why you have to bring them under the authority of the word of the Lord. He had a mind to serve and he had a mind to submit. Now, your mind to serve and your mind to submit will lead you to a life of sacrificial living. And you do understand that God only accepts sacrifices. Oh, my God. We'll talk about that in a little bit more here. Now, I want you to understand something here. Our mode of transportation and transition in the mind. Oh, my God. Our mode of transportation and transition in our minds. Watch this here. How God gets us from one place in life to the next place in life is through our minds. Let me put it that way. Our mode of getting us through life is in our minds. How we metamorphose, how we transition is in our minds. He says it this way right here. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. We're going to get somewhere in a minute here. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. The Bible talks about in Genesis how God said, let us make man in our image, alrighty, after our likeness, and you know that. And then the Bible talks about in chapter number 2 of Genesis, around verse number 7, it says that man was formed of the dust, alrighty, but yet he was there until God breathed in him. And the Bible says that God breathed in his nostrils. He breathed into his nostrils. He breathed into his mind, and man became a living being. Oh, I want you to get this here. Man became a living being when God breathed into his mind. And that's why you got to protect your mind. You got to pray that the enemy, oh my God, he's after your mind. You have to pray that God keep our minds, that God keep our minds. Why is this important? All right, I'm just laying a foundation here. This is important because wherever the mind goes, the man will follow. Where the mind goes, the man will follow. When you start thinking on a thing and after a while you start moving towards that thing, and you got to be careful because a lot of us, we're in our homes now, we're quarantined now, and our outlet is social media. Oh yeah, let me go down this road here. Our outlet is social media, and you need to be careful where you travel on social media. For you end up worse than you were before you went in. Oh, Lord, I know. You want cookies and milk right now, but I need to give you this here. Hear me good. You have to be careful because where the mind goes, the man will follow. And the average mind, the normal mind on a daily basis thinks between 60 and 80,000 thoughts a day. Now, where do these thoughts come from? Things that you see. Things that you keep putting in your eye gate, things that you put before your ear gate, all righty? And so you got to be careful. Where the mind goes, the man will follow. Genesis chapter number 13, it talks about it like this here. It says, and Lot looked towards Sodom. And then the next verse says, and Lot went towards Sodom. Whatever you start looking towards, you start going towards. And you got to be careful. You got to be careful because it's hard to have an effective prayer life when you have so many different things running through your mind. It's almost impossible to be the man that God wants you to be and the woman that God wants you to be when you have so many different things cluttering your mind. This is why some people can't pray that long. This is why they can't stay in prayer. This is why some of them can't stick to a regimen of fasting and prayer, because so much stuff is infiltrating in the mind. Now, when you have your mind made up, I'm telling you, the late, great Dr. Rosa Parks said it this way. She says, when an individual has his or her mind made up, their fear begins to diminish. When you have your mind made up, I mean, obstacles and oppositions begin to move out of your way. 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, watch this here. God has not given unto us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. You got to set your mind towards what it is that you're believing God for. You got to set your mind towards what it is that you want God to do in your life. You have to, it's not just good enough for us to pray for you. You got to bring your mind into alignment. See, because whenever you start bringing your mind into alignment, you said, I'm not going to take nothing except what God has promised me through his word. And his word is now in my mind. It's in my mouth. It's in my heart. I'm telling you, the devil in hell can't withstand you. Hear me good on this one here. The Bible talks about in the book of Ruth, that's about chapter number 1, it's only 4 chapters there, in the book of Ruth, that when Naomi saw that Ruth was steadfast in her mind, and she was committed and determined to go with her, she stopped arguing with her. She said, no, you know what, this girl has her mind made up. I'm not going to be able to deny her what it is that she wants to do. And I'm telling you right now, same God back then, same God today, same God tomorrow. Once you set your mind towards it, you'll accomplish it. You'll get it done. Let me move on just a little bit here so I can get to the point I want to get to here. Now, understand something, my friends and believers, that growing old is mandatory, but growing up is optional. Growing old is mandatory. You're going to grow old from the time you step from eternity into time, you start growing old. But growing up, that's an option. And you have to understand something here. Let me say this here. I'm not a psychologist, but I understand psychology. If you don't understand psychology, then it's hard sometimes to apply the right theology. And so sometimes, let me put a dime in the meter. Sometimes being an itinerant preacher, when I go different places, I ask sometimes, what is the average age of your congregation? What is the average age of the people in your community? What is the average age of the people who you have serving in ministry? And this is imperative, because sometimes we're trying to figure out people and we're trying to put the theology, when sometimes you might need to hold the theology just for a second and understand some psychology. Some time ago, I'll say this, our ushers ministry, have a wonderful ushers ministry. And a couple of years ago, our usher lead came to me and she said that one of our members in the ushers ministry, she's sweet as pie. And she says, but she don't want to usher that much. You know, she only wants to be on the schedule maybe once, twice every 2 to 3 months. And I said, I understand. And she said, I don't get that. How is that? And I said, well, you got to realize that lady there is in her 60s. And our usher lead said to me at the time, well, what does that have to do with anything? And I said, you have to understand that there are 4 stages of life from the time you're born to about 18, 19. That is the imagination stage. That's the imagination stage. And then from the time about 19 to about maybe 30s, I get about 30s, 19, 20 to about 30s, that's the exploring stage. I'm gonna come back and expound on this here. Alrighty. And then after about 32, 33, all the way up to maybe your late 50s, that's the engaging stage. Mid 50s. That's the engaging stage. And then late 50s and on, that's the disengaging stage. The problem that she was having with the usher had nothing to do about whether she loved God or not. I knew the woman loved God. The woman was just in a disconnecting stage of life. And guess what? Sometimes if you don't understand where people are mentally, you'll start misdiagnosing them. You'll start thinking that something is wrong. No, they're disengaging. Now, here's the thing here. Watch this here, and I'm going to be a little bit more transparent here. From birth to about 18, 19, that's that imagination stage of life. And a lot of times when you have a lot of millennials, and I love the young people. I'm raising two millennials here, my wife and I, but they're in the imagination stage of life. And you have to understand that. So video games have them watching different things on television. They have, and this is a healthy place to be in. Oh, I'm talking good talk here. I hope you're jotting some of this down. This is a healthy place to be in, and you have to allow them to finish that imagination stage. Then they get into the exploring stage. When they get into the exploring stage from about 19 to about 30-ish, they start exploring. They start, let me see, that's when they go to college. And when they go to college, they want to study one thing 1 month. And then a few months later, they want to change the major. That's when 1 week they work at Foot Locker. Is Foot Locker still around? Or they work at one of the tennis shoe stores. And then the next week, they work in the music business. They're kind of moving back and forth, moving back and forth. I was counseling with a pastor some time ago, and I asked him, I said, what's going on, man? How's your ministry doing? He said, man, the people coming and they flip-flopping and jumping around and so on and so forth. And I asked him, what's the average age of your congregation? He said, mid-20s, 30s. I said, well, that's to be expected. They're in that exploring stage. You understand where I'm coming from? That's a dangerous stage right there to expect people to wholeheartedly engage and commit. I'm not saying that they don't. Let me help you right there. But when you understand the mindset behind it, I got married in the exploring stage. Yes. I mean, you know, you're life-changing. You know I'm going to be very transparent already. I love my wife. God knows I love her. But we got married. I was 24 years old. Man, let me tell you something. Hindsight, Lord have mercy. I ain't had no business getting married at no 24, and couldn't nobody tell me nothing. 24 years old. I'm right in the, let me just throw it out there now before somebody get upset. I'm not saying that if you're married in your 20s, that marriage ain't for you. I'm talking about me right now, so put your feelings on the shelf, okay? I feel that in the spirit, all right? At 24, I'm telling you, and then one day I wake up and realize I have not finished the exploring stage of life. Now I got wife and children. Ain't nobody saying nothing right now. Ain't that something y'all looking at me funny? Now I got wife and children, and watch this here. And I'm trying to apply the theology to it when the truth of the matter was, it's not the theology, it's the psychology. I need the theology to bring me back to the right psychology. And that's when I had to ask God, God, recalibrate my mind. Bring me back. Put me in the right stage of life. Didn't finish the imagination stage, just like some of y'all who I'm watching. Some of y'all, who watching me, didn't finish the imagination stage because by the time some of you all were teenagers, you were out working and helping pay bills and taking care of folk. Come on, y'all not talking back to me now. Watch this here. And it took you out of that imagination stage. And before you know it, you were thrown into the engaging stage and skipped right over the exploring stage. And that's why at 22, you trying to disengage, talking about you tired because you all mixed up all over the place. And then you come to church and expect the preacher to fix it in 40 minutes. The devil is a liar. Guess what? We got to pray that God will recalibrate our mind. This is what the saints of old used to say. The saints of old, and I know y'all remember this one right here. The saints of old used to say that God is a mind regulator. Yes, he is. That's the problem some of y'all having in your relationships. It ain't that she don't love you. She's just not in the right stage. Oh my God. It's not that he doesn't care. He just didn't finish the right stage. And you think coming to church and screaming and hollering is going to fix it? The devil is a liar. Some folk need to go get some therapy. Woo! Need to go get some therapy. And we laying hands, greasing you up, pushing you in the float, and you get up. And sometimes you worse off than it was before you came because we don't understand that. Guess what? That's why sometimes you got to go see the psychologist. Ain't nobody talking back to me up in here. And we don't do that. You know, sometimes you go through a hardship, you lose a loved one, You go through a divorce. This is Bible study, right? You go through a divorce, and we don't go to counseling, especially us African Americans. No, we fix it with fried chicken and potato salad and pound cake and put rum in. Face liar. Guess what? We have to continue to ask God to regulate our minds. Regulate our minds. Regulate our minds. Now, watch this here. When God begins to regulate our minds, I'm going to move over here and I'm going to get out of here. When God begins to regulate our minds, I trust you enjoying this because I'm enjoying giving it to you. When God begins to regulate our minds, the regulation of our minds start with repentance. Oh, get that there. The regulation of your mind starts with repentance. It doesn't start with blaming everybody else for what happened to you. And I'm not being insensitive. Yes, many people were hurt at the hands of others, okay? Yes, many people were disappointed at the hands of others. But let me say this to you. Shame on them if they knocked you down. Shame on you if 15 years later you still laying there. All right, nobody's saying nothing to me now. All right. And sometimes as you continue to grow, you can't keep looking back in the rearview mirror, upset about what he did to you, what she did to you. You got to come to a place sometime and say, you know what? I've got to make up in my mind that I got to get over this here. Now, when we start talking about repentance, sometimes you got to forgive them and you got to forgive yourself. You got to forgive them and you got to forgive yourself. Somebody saying, now why is Bishop talking like this when we all quarantine? He should be coming up giving us three nice points that start with the same alphabet and tell us how wonderful things are. So we, no, because some of y'all going cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs being in the house all the time, having to deal with that difficult one all the time. And you need to start understanding, you walk around telling some Satan, the Lord rebuke you, the blood of Jesus, and I believe in rebuking the devil and covering us under blood. But sometimes you need to sit down and find out, wait a minute, were you like this before I married you? Wait a minute, you was always under your mama's skirt and you was always under your mama's apron, and now I got you and I ain't good for that. And now, hey, come on now, be for real. All right. And so this is what you need, because we need to start praying that God would recalibrate our minds. All right. So now let me move on here. What my time look like? Oh, I'm good on time. When it comes to God regulating our minds, it starts with repentance. It starts with repentance. You know, I tell you, First Lady and I, we're going to do a session together real soon. We're going to go live together real soon and talk about relationships and talk about things that take place in marriage, good, bad, and indifferent, from a biblical perspective to bring people to a righteous resolve. And I'm telling you right now, for years, I almost messed this marriage up, blaming her for stuff that happened to me, vice versa, her blaming me for stuff that happened to her. And I'm gonna tell you right now, brothers, y'all that's married, all right, y'all that's thinking about getting married, if you really wanna know how Jesus felt, all right, you'll learn in that marriage. Because sometimes everything that don't go right, whether it's your fault or not, you're gonna have to take the blame for it. Jesus never committed a sin. Get that look off your face. Look at that. I don't agree with that. You ain't got to agree with it. Jesus never committed a sin, but yet he died for all sins. All righty? He lived that sacrificial life. And sometimes when you go into that relationship, that person is hurt and wounded, and you got to be patient enough and have the right mindset to bring some healing to them. Oh, my God. Vice versa. You know, ladies, you go into a marriage sometime, that man is broken and wounded. And it's something, because, you know, when men go into a marriage, you know, when men go into a relationship, somebody need this here. We go into that relationship and this is what we're saying. We're saying, I just pray to God, she's the right one. And we go into that relationship for where she is right now. Right now, if she just stay like this here, everything will be all right. This is where we are. And then the woman goes into the marriage relationship thinking, I can change that man. I don't care what he's been through. I don't care how long he's been through it. I can change that man. Yes, I can. And what happens is when they get down the road, he hasn't changed and she has. And his complaint becomes, you've changed. And her argument becomes, you haven't changed. You still doing the same thing you was doing when I met you back in 77 or 87 or 97. And we start getting upset and we start praying prayers. God, get me out of this. And God goes, no, I'm going to get you through this before you break up. You're going to break through. But you got to pray the right prayers. What is the right prayer? Lord, regulate my mind. I need to be on national TV with this here. Lord, regulate my mind. You know, and people, they get fooled by social media statuses. You know, you look at people's status on social media and all they show you is the beautiful stuff and everybody looking beautiful and fine. Don't even understand. Sometimes they fussing and arguing even in the midst of those posts. And sometimes once you get beyond the veil to realize that, guess what? It's some stuff going on in our minds, in our minds. And so we need God to regulate our mind. And this has been my prayer. Now, God, regulate my mind. God, keep my mind. Lord, I went through some things and did not finish the imagination stage. God, regulate my mind. I made some adult decisions when I should have been in the exploring stage. God, regulate my mind. God, here I am now trying to get into the engaging stage to where I need a career, God. I need things to be serious in my life. I'm talking to somebody now. God, regulate my mind. And then here you are at 65 trying to grind like you 22. Baby, you need God to regulate your mind. Regulate my mind, God. Regulate my mind. You 72 years old, still out there trying to hustle like you 30, like you explore. No, you need God to regulate your mind. And this is my prayer. This is my prayer that God will regulate our minds. Let me get on out of here now. Watch this here. Now, when God regulates our minds, it starts with repentance. It starts with repentance. You have to repent. You have to repent. You have to repent. Thank you, kind spirit. You have to repent. You have to repent. Watch this here. Even on a daily basis, you have to repent. Stuff you see and stuff you think and stuff you hear, you have to repent. You know, I'm going to be transparent to get you. Watch this here. And we have to repent of these wicked thoughts. Yes, we do. We have to repent of these wicked thoughts. I was in the garage. When was it 70 degrees? Was it yesterday or the day before? Sunday. Lord help me, Jesus. Sunday, the day, Wednesday. Sunday. It was real nice out Sunday here in Maryland. And I was in the garage messing around, you know, putting wax on the car and just fumbling around in the garage. That's my little domain, be out there messing around. And I had the radio on Sunday evening. I had the radio on. And I'm talking to you now about having to repent for stuff that come against your mind. I had the radio on and a song came on the radio. I ain't gonna tell you what it was. And I'm telling you right now, I started grooving and I'm saying, oh Lord, that took me back to my strip club days. What? Did he just say that? Took me back to my strip club days, back there to where you was making it rain. My mind done went back, Lord have mercy, to watching women on a pole on a Sunday. Why? Because of a song that came on the radio. Now all I see is strippers. And you mean to tell me you don't have to repent for your mind? I'm talking about the bishop, the preacher, God's mouthpiece for the people. I'm in the garage. I'm just grooming. Oh, yeah, that's that joint right there. Doc. Yeah, get me a little Hennessy and some Coke. Oh, man, that's it right there. That, ooh. I remember her. I remember her. I remember. And your mind done gone there. And you got to be careful because where the mind goes, the man will follow. And that's why you got to bring every thought. Oh, come on, you got to bring it into captivity. You got to capture it. And before you know it, my wife opened up the door and said, like you be having a party. I said, whoa. Lord, help me, Jesus. Brought me right back in. God's got a way of doing it. Brought me right back in. She said, I'm sitting here just watching you spinning all around here like you one of the Jackson 5. What's going on here? I had nothing. I'm good. Nothing. Then I had to go and repent. Y'all not talking back to me. Had to go and repent. You got to be careful, stuff you watching on television. Got to go and repent. It'll start planting seeds in your mind. Oh, my God. Watch this here. Genesis 6 and 5, I'm done. I ain't going to finish with this. Maybe I'll pick it up later on, all right? It says, and God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Good God Almighty. Genesis 6 and 5 says, God saw the wickedness of his thoughts, and they were evil continually, continually evil thoughts. Everything he thought was wicked and evil. And this is why we have to repent. Bible says in 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, if my people, you know this, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked way. Well, where does wicked ways start at? Wicked ways starts in your thoughts. Good God Almighty. I'm cooking. I'm telling you right now. You getting this. You need this here. Starts in your thoughts. You got to get your mind out of it. See, because watch this here. Your thoughts will become your words. Okay? Your words will become your actions. Your actions will become your habits. Your habits will become your values. I said your thoughts will become your words. Your thought. Why did he say that? Because that's what he thinking. Come on now. That's what he thinking. Why is he doing that? Because that's what he said. Your words will become your actions. Your actions will become your habits. Your habits will become your values. And your values will become your destiny. Wrong mindset will lead to the wrong requests. If you don't have the right mindset and you go into prayer, you'll be praying for the wrong stuff. Oh, my God. I'll tell you, I wish I had more time to spend with you here. If you don't have the right mindset, you'll start drifting off. Y'all give me 7 more minutes. I mean, where we got to go, all of us quarantined, okay? Watch this here. If you don't have the right mindset, then you start praying the wrong prayers. Oh, my God. And I told you, watch this here. Hit me good on this here. You can have the wrong mindset and start praying the wrong prayers and get your answer. And when you get your answer, you think because it was released to you that it was for you. No. Let's mature a little bit here. Sometimes the wrong mindset, the wrong prayers. And then when you go after it like you've never gone after it before, and then it's released to you, then you go, God must want me to have it. No, that doesn't mean that. That doesn't mean that. Somebody said, well, what are you talking about, Bishop? You remember over in the book of 1 Samuel where Israel wanted a king, and God sent Samuel down there and told him, tell them folk, I'm going to be their king. But no, they were persistent. We want us a king like all the other nations. After a while, God gave them their king. And what did he do? The same thing God told him. You know how it is. Everybody told you she wasn't right. Everybody told you he wasn't no good. Y'all make me go here now, all right? You're looking at me sideways. Everybody told you that they wasn't. That boy ain't right. That girl ain't no. No, that ain't the one you want. Everybody know her. Bruh, you better watch out. That boy playing on both teams. But you wouldn't listen. And so you went on into it, and now you're sitting there wondering, well, why am I like this, and what is going on? Everybody trying to tell you. I know what I'm talking about. I done made business deals. Lord have mercy. I mean, I done lost money in business deals here. My God. And didn't want to hear what nobody had to say, because I just felt, this me and God, and my wife telling me, Jay, you shouldn't invest in that. I don't think you should do this, that, and other. And I'm sitting there going, no, this is what I want to do. And look, the Lord is releasing it. And then here it is, the bottom falls out, or it doesn't go right, and then you mad. And the book of Proverbs says, you make bad decisions and then blame other people for them. Ooh, I'm cooking with hot grease here. And so you got to understand this here. So it starts with repentance. All right, I'm coming on in. I'm done. It starts with repentance. And all of us have been there. All of us. Well, you know, not me, Bishop. Well, keep living. Tomorrow might be your day. All righty? Not me. I hear you in the Holy Ghost. Mm-mm. Listen, you got to repent. The Bible talks about Luke 15. Let me get out of here. Luke 15. I'm enjoying myself here. Luke 15 says, and a certain man had two sons, And the younger of them said to his father, Dad, give me the portion that falls to me. He made a request to his daddy. After he made that request, verse number 13, the Bible talks about he departed. He began to roam. He just began to go off. And when he began to roam out there and go off, he had no root in him. Nobody couldn't tell him anything. Read it when you get a chance. They couldn't tell him anything. And the Bible said that he spent all of his living in riotous, oh my God, riotous living. He spent all of his money in riotous living. And then he was reduced in verse number 14. And when he had spent all, the Bible says, there arose a great famine in that land. And he began to be in want. And then guess what? He compromised and found himself there in the hog's pen, getting ready to eat with the pigs. My God, read it when you get a chance. Luke 15. And then all of a sudden, God sent a mind regulation. It says, then he came to himself. Would you be honest and decree and declare? I'm going to see if you be honest. There was some stuff that you would have done had God not regulated your mind. There were some people you would have hung out with had God not regulated your mind. There would have been decisions that you would have made had God not regulated your mind. And if you don't do nothing else, you ought to be able to open your mouth and thank God that he brought you back to your right mind. You almost had an affair. You almost went back to drinking. You almost pulled up to the strip club. You was getting ready to go buy another dime bag. You was getting ready to light it up. But thanks be to God who regulated my mind. When you find yourself should have been home by a certain time, and you cruising the streets at night, thank God for the quarantine. It's saving a whole lot of our lives here because he has to regulate our mind. Telephone rang, regulated your mind. Song came on the radio, regulated your mind. Facebook post, you know what? Don't you sit there and look at me like that. You know, had it not been for God regulating your mind, you were just an accident waiting to happen. And I dare you to open your mouth and decree and declare that he's a mind regulator. Even in the midst of all that we're going through, he's a mind regulator. And the Bible says that he came to himself. You know, I don't enjoy nothing more than teaching the word of God here. Bible says he came to himself, and when he came to himself, watch this here, he was reformed. And verse number 18 says, I will go to my father's house, and I will say that I have sinned, and I'm not worthy to be called your son. He began to restructure things. Then he returned back to his father. When he returned back, he came back repenting. Oh my God. Right then, verse number 21 of Luke 15, he came back repenting, and then that's when the Father reinstated him. If you want God to regulate your mind, you got to repent and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I've said things I should not have said. I've done things I should not have done. I've gone places I should not have gone. Lord, this has been my present time. God, I'd have messed up with business and a whole lot of money have gone through my hands. God, regulate my mind, because when God regulates your mind, he'll begin to reestablish you. He'll begin to restore you. And this is my prayer, that even while we're quarantined, that God will regulate our minds, that he will keep us in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him. That's my prayer for you right now. That's my prayer for you right now, that God will regulate your mind. The enemy crept into the garden, my God, in Genesis chapter number 3 and messed their minds up. But by the time we get to Matthew 27, Jesus is dying out on a hill shaped like a skull to give you back your right mind. And I decree and I declare right now, the devil can't have your mind. He can't have your mind. He can't have your emotions. He cannot rule over your thoughts. The devil, I dare you to just slip your hands up where you are in the name of Jesus and say, God, restore my mind. I'm telling you, the right mind will take you from mites to million. That's 2 Kings chapter number 7. The Bible said that there were 4 lepers at the gate. They were broke, but by the time it was over, they were billionaires. By the time you went into the quarantine, you went in with one mind, but when you coming out, you coming out with another mind. And my prayer is, God, keep our mind. minds, Lord. Keep our minds, oh God. Don't let us drift off into things that we have no business drifting off into. Don't let us peruse the internet into things that we have no business going into. God, we need you to keep our minds when it comes to our marriages. Keep our minds, Lord, when it comes to raising our children. Keep our minds, oh God, when it comes to ministry and money, oh God. Keep our minds in the name. I need you to start praying with me. In the name of Jesus, I bind the devil on every side. God, you're the great mind regulator. God, I come against the enemy that brings fear to the minds of the people. I come against the enemy that brings doubt to the minds of the people. I come against the enemy, Father, that brings the spirit of quit to the minds of the people. I speak to you right now, man of God. I speak to you right now, woman of God. Don't you throw in the towel. This quarantine, this time away from your congregation, it's not your exit out to go into something else. The devil is a liar. You're going to endure this test. You're going to pass this test. Your breakthrough is just around the corner. Satan, the Lord rebuke you right now. I know it's been rough for you, man of God and woman of God, but I touch and agree with you in the realm of the spirit that before you break down and quit, you will break through to another dimension and you will see that it was worth the journey. God, I pray in the name of Jesus for relationships right now, God. I pray right now, God, that you will recalibrate, Father, that you will reform, oh God, that you will readjust, oh God, mindsets right now in the name of Jesus, God, whom you have joined together. God, I pray right now, God, that you keep us. My God, my God, my God. God, that you would keep us and mold our thoughts. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. The blood of Jesus is against you right now. God, I thank you for recalibrating our minds in the name of Jesus. And for this, we say thank you and we bless God for it right now. We bless God for it right now. We bless God for it right now. In Jesus' name, thou shalt be above and never beneath. You got to put it in your mind. Thou shalt be the head and not the tail. You got to put it in your mind. Your downsetting shall be blessed. Put it in your mind. Your uprising shall be blessed. Put it in your mind that you shall live and not die. Put it in your mind that you shall be the lender and not the borrower. Put it in your mind. And once you put it in your mind, you got to put it in your words. I'm telling you right now, you got to be able to decree that thing and say it in the name of Jesus that your ladder shall be greater. Oh my God. That better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. You got to begin to decree it in the it's in my mind that when the saints of God come back together, we're going to come back together, Father, healthy and whole. Oh God, we're going to come back together, Father, as if, Father, we've never been apart, Father, with a renewed spirit, with a renewed commitment, with a renewed mind. In the name of Jesus, I decree and I declare it over your life right now that you're winning in this season. You got to keep that mindset. You're winning in this season. The Bible says, look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Hebrews 12, 1 through 3. Watch this here. Lest ye be weary and faint in your mind. You are not going to give up in this season. You're going to go up in this season. This is not working against you. It's working for you. This is not something that is happening to us. It is something that is happening for us. And I decree and I declare right now, God is raising your mind. Whatsoever things you begin to think, oh my God, think up, think up, think up. And for this, we say thank you. In Jesus' name, we praise you right now. Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. God, I thank you right now. In the name of Jesus. That's right. No weapon formed against you. Get it in your mind. Shall prosper. In the name of Jesus. And Father, we bless you for it. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. I'm getting ready to sign off here. I'm getting ready to sign off. Don't leave until I get a benediction. Listen, I'm getting ready to sign off. And as I get ready to go, I want you to know I'm going into prayer. I'm going into prayer. That is my prayer, that God will continue to keep the minds of his people, that he will keep our minds, and that he will watch over us and keep our minds in the name of Jesus. All righty? Listen, I thank all of you all. I'm serious. I thank all of you all for tuning in. I'll be back here, if the Lord says, the same Saturday at 7 p.m. Saturday at 7 p.m., all righty? And I'm believing God to do great and mighty things. Let me challenge you one more time, all righty? Let me challenge you again. Those who have been giving to this ministry, I appreciate it. Many of our ministry partners, amen, some of those who are chiming in, I thank you so very much and life-changing. Thank you for your tithing and your offering. Now, there are some you still need to step up. You still need to step up. Get that mindset, all righty, that I must sow into the kingdom of God. Our Cash App is $LifeChanging1. All righty, sow a seed. Sow the seed, all right? $LifeChanging1. Our Giblify is Life-Changing Christian Center. Or you can go to the church website. You can give on the church website at lifechangingcc.info, okay? And click the donate tab, and you're able to give there. All righty, thank you all so much. Life, I love you, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. Hugs and kisses to each and every one of y'all. Hug the children for me, please. Please hug the babies for me. Let them know that Bishop and First Lady says hello. And we'll be back together sooner than later. I really believe that in Jesus' name. Y'all be safe. Obey. Be safe. Submit. Don't buck the system. All righty? Don't do that. Obey. All righty? And take care. God bless you. God keep you. I love you. And we'll talk again. I'll be back here Saturday at 7 p.m. I pray that God keeps your mind in Jesus' name.